Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ranger School, Discipline, Direction, Determination, by Jimmy Blackmon, narrated by Jimmy Blackmon. Forward. This is the single most important book to read in order to understand military leadership, the U.S. Armed Forces' most elite warriors, and their role in the decades-long wars after the 9/11 terrorist attacks. The first thing to understand is that Ranger School is a leadership school. Not all Rangers go from the school to the 75th Ranger Regiment. Many of them, like Jimmy Blackmon, go to other units. But all of them bear the Ranger tab on their uniform, and that patch is a universal symbol of leadership excellence. Ranger School, Discipline, Direction, Determination, delves into the fearsome forge that takes mere mortals of flesh and blood and hammers them into the quiet professionals who wear the Ranger tab. Along with Jimmy Blackmon's excellent books, Cowboys Over Iraq and Pale Horse, this book is the first volume in an amazing trilogy, a triad of masterful storytelling that illuminates and informs the reader about military leadership, the global war on terror, and the remarkable career of one of the most extraordinary frontline combat leaders in U.S. military history. In the 1980s, I had the honor to work with Jerry Ledzinski, who had been a Special Forces A-team leader during the Vietnam War. For many years during that long and brutal war, U.S. Special Forces, a.k.a. Green Berets, operated behind enemy lines in Cambodia, Laos, and North Vietnam. Serving as a captain in command of one of these A-teams has been recognized as the single most dangerous job in that war. Only one man had survived 2 6-month tours of duty in this position, and then one man survived 6 tours. That man was Jerry Ledzinski. I asked Jerry, "How do you survive 6 tours in this position?" I expected him to say something about his experiences at West Point or his Special Forces training. No. Maybe it was some influence of his family or his upbringing. No. Maybe it was his previous combat experience as a young lieutenant leading paratroopers in the 82nd Airborne Division in the Dominican Republic. No. Jerry said, it was all Ranger School. The military troop leading procedures model is the most powerful problem-solving process the world has ever seen. Ranger School carved that problem-solving process into our neurons, and it works. It is all that kept me alive year after year. Jerry, who left the Army after the Vietnam War, went on to say, "Today I run a multi-million-dollar investment business, and I do it with the tools I was taught to use in Ranger School." In the 1990s, I was able to touch base with Jerry Ledzinski again. He told me about a new Templeton investment fund that was accepting bids in a worldwide competition to select the individual who would manage this multi-million-dollar endeavor. Jerry won the competition by submitting a 5-paragraph operations order that he said blew Templeton out of the water. That is the secret of Ranger School. The skills that we learn and successfully apply under great stress, as per Ranger School, are carved into our neurons and indelibly woven into our existence. And that is Ranger School's gift that keeps on giving. The result, represented by the Ranger tab on a soldier's uniform, is an unbreakable, never-quit attitude and absolute mastery of that military problem-solving process. It is a form of leadership magic that is carved into your soul. The battlefield is the most unforgiving, deadly, dangerous field of endeavor known to man. The process of military leadership that has evolved across centuries of warfare is the end product of a deadly Darwinian evolution. That is why U.S. military officers were chosen to lead the vast majority of our corporations in the post-World War II era. Today, former U.S. military officers still represent a disproportionate amount of corporate leadership positions, and officers leaving the U.S. military are heavily recruited for corporate leadership. And that is what Jimmy Blackmon teaches today in his executive leadership series, dynamic and engaging keynote presentations, and training seminars for business leaders worldwide. I graduated from Ranger School in 1979, and it was the single most powerful military experience in my career. I've authored many books, but I could never have written this book. Jimmy Blackmon has an amazing memory, while for me, much of Ranger School was a dull blur, and his later books combined to make his literary contributions greater than the sum of the parts. One of my favorite World War II authors is John Masters. His book, Bugles and a Tiger, gives great insight into a British Gurkha unit and British officer professional development pre-war. Then his Road Past Mandalay followed Masters' experience in a Gurkha unit during World War II. The impact of these two books is greater than the sum of the parts. It is truly a transcendent combination, a war story to the second power, giving a deep and profound insight into a soldier's life and the British military experience in World War II. And that is what Jimmy Blackmon has given us in his books. Read this book, and then read his other books, if you have not already done so. Read, experience, and understand the most brutal, effective, and powerful leadership school known to man. Well done, Ranger Blackmon. Rangers lead the way. Dave Grossman, Lieutenant Colonel, United States Army, retired, author of On Killing, On Combat, On Spiritual Combat, On Killing Remotely, and Assassination Generation. Preface. The United States Army's Ranger School is one of the most arduous military schools in the world, if not the hardest. It is open to soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines in the U.S. Armed Forces, as well as select Allied military members. The course is high risk and completely voluntary. Aspiring Rangers must first make it through their locally run, rigorous screening courses before they can even be considered for the school itself. In other words, you can fail out of Ranger School before you even get there. Army Rangers are charged with handling some of the most complex and challenging problems our nation faces. So naturally, the training required to become a Ranger is rigorous, and only the most mentally and physically strong graduate the course. Rangers are among the nation's most elite soldiers, with a rich history that predates the Revolutionary War. Famously, Major Robert Rogers, a flawed yet tactically brilliant officer, used his company of Rangers to fight in the French and Indian War. Rogers wrote 19 standing orders and 28 rules of ranging. Still today, Rogers' standing orders are printed on the inside cover of the Ranger Handbook. They are as follows. 1. Don't forget nothing. 2. Have your musket clean as a whistle, hatchet scoured, 60 rounds powder and ball, and be ready to march at a minute's warning. 3. When you're on the march, act the way you would if you were sneaking up on a deer. See the enemy first. 4. Tell the truth about what you see and what you do. There's an army depending on us for correct information. You can lie all you please when you tell other folks about the Rangers, but don't never lie to a Ranger or an officer. 5. Don't never take a chance you don't have to. 6. When we're on the march, we march single file, far enough apart so one shot can't go through two men. 7. If we strike swamps or soft ground, we spread out abreast so it's hard to track us. 8. When we march, we keep moving till dark so as to give the enemy the least possible chance at us. 9. When we camp, half the party stays awake while the other half sleeps. 10. If we take prisoners, we keep them separate till we have time to examine them, so they can't cook up a story between them. 11. Don't ever march home the same way. Take a different route so you won't be ambushed. 12. No matter whether we travel in big parties or little ones, each party has to keep a scout 20 yards ahead, 20 yards on each flank, and 20 yards in the rear, so the main body can't be surprised and wiped out. 13. Every night, you'll be told where to meet if surrounded by a superior force. 14. Don't sit down to eat without posting sentries. 15. Don't sleep beyond dawn. Dawn's when the French and Indians attack. 16. Don't cross a river by a regular ford. 17. If somebody's trailing you, make a circle. Come back on your own tracks and ambush the folks that aim to ambush you. 18. Don't stand up when the enemy's coming against you. Kneel down, lie down, hide behind a tree. 19. Let the enemy come till he's almost close enough to touch. Then let him have it and jump out and finish him up with your hatchet. Rogers hand-picked his Rangers. Back then, they were a rough bunch, including some rabble-rousers and whorehouse owners. Interestingly, Rogers was an innovator. In an age where British regulars stood in lines and fired muskets in a volley, Rogers went completely asymmetric. He was anything but status quo. He attracted men with a high tolerance for risk. From ice skating across rivers in the dead of night to hiding out in enemy territory for weeks on end, Rogers was an inventive leader who could not have conceived the legacy he would leave. The British and later American Army saw the value of Rogers' methods, thus his rules and tactics have passed the test of time. Eventually, Army leadership decided that a formalized process was probably better than recruiting rough and rowdy characters from the fringes of society. In 1950, during the Korean War, Ranger School was born, and since that time, the course has undergone countless changes to the training regimen. Desert Phase, for example, was added to the course in 1983, only to be removed in 1995. The elimination of Desert Phase was simple economics. Flying Ranger students and Ranger instructors, RIs, back and forth across the country was cost prohibitive. The duration of the course has varied from 58 days to 68 days. Even the order of events within individual phases often varies. Due to the extreme nature of the training, safety is naturally a concern in Ranger School. For example, severe weather often forces the Ranger instructors, RIs, to modify the training in order to avoid hyperthermia in winter and heat stroke in summer. No two Ranger School classes are alike. In fact, no two Rangers experience the same course in the same way. That is the brilliance of Ranger School. The end result is the same. A hardened, wiser leader who uniquely understands what a soldier is mentally and physically capable of and who is prepared to lead in ways he had never thought possible. In order to experience the diverse environments in which Army Rangers operate, the Army conducts the course in various locations throughout the United States. My class began the course at Fort Benning, Georgia, home of the Ranger Training Brigade, on November 2, 1992. We parachuted into Desert Phase, Camp McGregor, New Mexico, the week before Thanksgiving. We moved on to Mountain Phase, Camp Frank D. Merrill, near Dahlonega, Georgia, the first week of December, and finished that phase of training 5 days prior to Christmas. Upon completion of Mountain Phase, we were released for Christmas break. Swamp Phase, which is conducted at Camp Rudder, Florida, began on January the 4th and ended on January 20th. Class 2-93 graduated on January the 22nd, 1993. I left a lot of blood, sweat, and tears at each location, but along the way, I learned more about myself than I could ever have imagined. I would be remiss if I did not note that a soldier who successfully graduates Ranger School earns the right to wear the coveted Ranger tab throughout their career. They are considered Ranger qualified. However, that does not mean that they will ever serve in the 75th Ranger Regiment, which is the Army's only Ranger unit and its premier light infantry fighting force. They specialize in special operations raids, forcible entry operations, and special reconnaissance deep inside enemy territory. Those who do not go on to serve in the Ranger Regiment are distributed throughout the Army to serve in various leadership positions. Listeners will note that all Rangers in this book are male. At the time of the events in this book, Ranger School was only open to males. The first females to graduate Ranger School were Captain Shaylin Haver and Lieutenant Kristen Grist. They went through the course in 2015. I share these facts up front to ensure that the listener understands that this was my experience to the best of my recollection. In some cases, I recall only a fellow Ranger student's first or last name. In those cases, I've changed their names altogether. I've consulted with several fellow Rangers as well as Ranger instructors to try and be as accurate as possible. Nevertheless, at the writing of this book, 27 years have passed since Class 2-93 graduated. Inevitably, I've gotten some small detail wrong, and for that I'm sorry. However, in talking with my fellow Rangers, I found that our memories often align to a degree that suggests we remember the harrowing experience of Ranger School pretty much the way it was. In any case, I can promise that the emotions related here are 100% accurate. This is how I became a United States Army Ranger, one of the greatest accomplishments of my life. Winding Stair Gap. December 19, 1992. There was not a doubt in my mind. I was about to die and they didn't give a shit. 47 days into U.S. Army Ranger School, and I was well beyond anyone's common understanding of tired. Tired is what you are after a long day of mowing the lawn and weed eating. The Ranger School version of tired is significantly different. I was so exhausted, I thought I might fall down on the cold, hard ground, lose consciousness, and die quivering in the fetal position. The Ranger instructors, RIs, issued 800 milligram ibuprofen like candy. In fact, they called it Ranger candy, and they seemed to be under the impression that Ranger candy would cure whatever ails you. But the agonizing soreness I was experiencing was not muscle deep. It was bone deep, and nothing short of a month off was going to knock a dent in it. The 70-pound rucksack pulled on my shoulders like a freight train, and both my big toes had gone completely numb days prior. Rainwater ran down the crack of my ass like a river, and there wasn't one square inch of my back that did not ache. Every step I took brought pain to a degree I'd never thought I could endure. I'd lost 20 pounds in a month and a half. Hunger was my constant companion, but the gnawing in my stomach now paled in comparison to the pain in my feet and back. It was after midnight. The temperature hovered in the high 30s, and it was raining like a cow pissing on a flat rock when we arrived at the top of Winding Stair Gap. A thick layer of clouds blotted out the moon, making it impossible to see anything other than shapes in the darkness. "All right, Rangers, it's time to walk out of here," the RI said. "It's just over 10 miles back to camp, so suck it up and let's go." Several Rangers adjusted their shoulder straps on their rucksacks in preparation for the long walk out. No one spoke aloud, yet each of us carried on an incessant internal conversation, the mind trying to convince the body to keep going. As fate would have it, my squad was the support squad, which meant we carried the M60 machine guns. I began walking with the 23-pound gun draped around my neck by a sling. Winding Stair Gap Road is a small, rocky forestry road in northern Georgia. It descends at 7% grade over approximately 5 miles. Once at the bottom, we'd turn left onto another forestry road until we hit Hightower Church Road. From there, it's a 2-mile walk uphill back to Camp Frank D. Merrill. I knew the area well. I'd grown up in these mountains, but familiarity wasn't going to help me today. Employing Rogers' rules, we strung out along the road in two files. One ranger walked on the left side of the road, and the next ranger walked on the right. We weaved our way down the rocky road, trying to avoid deep ruts that were now flowing like tiny streams. My leather boots squished with water as I walked, and rain dripped from the brim of my cap to the back of my hand, which held a machine gun tightly to try and relieve the weight on my neck. Our weapons had to be oriented with a barrel out. Rangers on the right side of the road pointed their barrels to the right, and those on the left pointed theirs to the left. I'm right-handed, so it was awkward to handle the M60 primarily with my left hand. I put my head down, stared at the ground, and walked. But after a mile and a half or so, the pain in my neck, back, and left arm was excruciating. I had to get relief, but the RIs were not stopping. "We got a switch," I whispered to a fellow ranger. "I need a break." "Okay," he said, and we quickly took a knee in the center of the road. He was carrying the 16-pound machine gun tripod. While I took the M60 off my neck, he loosened the straps on his rucksack and removed the tripod. I then quickly strapped the tripod to the top of my ruck, and he shouldered the gun. My ruck now weighed well over 80 pounds, but switching to the tripod gave my neck temporary relief. Under such extreme duress, simply shifting the weight to another set of muscles made a profound difference. As I continued walking down the mountain, my feet began to burn. At first, it was only in my forefoot. Then my heels began to burn as well. It had rained for 3 days straight, so I knew my feet were pruned. Now, with each step I took, my feet slid forward in my boots, causing me to wince in pain. The leather had stretched due to the moisture, so there was more room for my feet to slide. I tried not to think about it. Just keep walking. All you have to do is make it back to camp, and mountain phase is over, I kept telling myself. Then I visualized that guy. That guy was a ranger I knew who had made it through ranger school and earned his tab, but who I thought was weaker than most. The fact that he had earned his tab surprised me. In my mind, I saw his face. Is that guy stronger than you? I asked myself. He earned his ranger tab. He faced his demons, and I'm sure he wanted to quit too, but he didn't, so I kept walking. A couple of miles later, the guys carrying the M60s wanted to swap again. This time, the RIs let us stop momentarily to switch. I took a knee and removed the tripod from my ruck. As I swapped with my ranger buddy, I could hear arguing just down the road. Some of the other rangers didn't want to swap. No one wanted to carry the machine gun. We were all hurting. It made sense to share the load, and in normal circumstances, we would have willingly helped one another. But in those extreme conditions, some rangers could not force themselves to simply do the right thing. We were learning a lot about ourselves and each other. Lightning streaked across the sky like glowing wires, illuminating dark clouds, and thunder echoed through the valleys. I'd come a long way, but my feet were now on fire, and for the first time, I wondered if I could physically make it. Since beginning ranger school, each of us had been faced with a binary choice, quit or keep going. Along the way, many men had opted for the former. I'd always been able to suck it up and keep rangering on until this point. Now, with both my feet on fire, it wasn't a matter of making a mental choice. I questioned if I could physically continue. Suddenly, I felt an emotion that instantly brought me to the verge of tears. Fear of failure. I'd made it this far. All I had to do was walk back to camp in order to complete mountain phase. Then only swamp phase would remain. This meant everything to me. But now this sudden, unexpected fear had changed things. It scared the hell out of me. I had suffered previously, but I'd survived. Quitting was never an option. Yet now I could be dropped from ranger school, not because I quit, but because my body had quit on me. And so for the first time, I was afraid of failure. I stumbled and almost fell. How could this be happening to me? Ranger Assessment Phase, 4th Ranger Training Battalion, Fort Benning, Georgia. Camp Rogers, November the 2nd, 1992. I stepped out of Brian Trainer's pickup truck at 0500 hours on a cold, dark November morning. Nervous anticipation hung in the air like static electricity. I hoisted my two duffel bags from the bed of his truck in a thick fog that hung ghost-like in the air above us. Brian walked around the truck to say goodbye. "Good luck, Jimmy," he said, putting his hand on my shoulder. His sentiment was neither encouraging nor congratulatory. Brian's demeanor was somber and serious, neighboring on sympathetic. I sensed pity in his eyes. This is because he understood precisely the adventure upon which I was embarking. Brian was my college classmate, and he had only recently earned the coveted black and gold ranger tab. The experience was still fresh in his mind. The scar tissue had yet to heal. He knew exactly what I was about to experience, and to be honest, I thought I knew how the next few months would go myself. I was certain that this would be the toughest military training I'd ever participated in, and no doubt I'd be pushed to my mental and physical limits. But I was fit and strong. In fact, I knew that I was among the top 1% physically. Also, several friends had told me what to expect and how to prepare. I'd just have to steel myself against the extreme hunger and sleep deprivation. Though there would certainly be a few surprises along the way, I felt confident that I knew how it would go. I had no idea. The day prior, I had driven from my apartment in Fort Rucker, Alabama, to Fort Benning, Georgia, where I spent the night with Brian in his quarters. That night, he'd draped a trash bag around me and shaved my head bald. We were up and eating breakfast, my final meal, at 0400 hours. Now here I stood with day zero of Ranger School about to begin. To be honest, it was somewhat surreal. I grew up the son of a mill worker from North Georgia. All I ever debated in high school was which shift I'd work. The mill was a foregone conclusion. Then an Army recruiter knocked on our raggedy screen door and asked, "Son, how'd you like to join the Army?" My father was drafted for the Korean War. He served his service obligation, then returned to Calhoun, Georgia, and hung that Eisenhower jacket in the closet. Corporal Blackmon. When the recruiter asked me if I wanted to join the Army, I saw myself in that uniform, a soldier. That was February 1986. I went to basic training that summer and then advanced individual training. I then used the Montgomery GI Bill to help with college. I attended North Georgia College, one of the four senior military colleges at that time, where I served as commander of the Corps of Cadets during my senior year. In 1991, I was commissioned a second lieutenant and subsequently reported to Fort Rucker, Alabama, for the Aviation Officer Basic Course and Flight School. From hourly wage to an officer in the United States Army, it was hard to believe. My career was off to a great start, but the next great challenge, the greatest crucible thus far in my life, lay before me. I took a deep breath, picked up my two duffel bags, and turned to walk through the gate. I once heard an old man say that if you have to do something hard, don't think on it too long or you'll talk yourself out of doing it. "Son," he said, "if you gotta swallow a frog, don't stare at him too long." So I didn't hesitate. I walked straight through the gates and never looked back. A small handwritten sign pointed the way to "In Processing." As I approached the tent, a sergeant intercepted me, the first RI I encountered. Ranger School's Cerberus, guarding the gates to a school that produced the world's most elite fighting men. He was not an overly large man. In fact, he defied the common Hollywood stereotype of a knuckle-dragging, door-kicking, tire-tool-swinging, bodybuilding Rambo type. This RI was lean and sinewy, no excess flesh. I could tell that he was more endurance than sheer power, a man that could handle his body weight well. He wore jungle boots, crisply starched BDU pants, and a black sweatshirt with a Ranger tab printed across the chest and a white name tag above it, Price. A Ranger tab was also sewn above the rank on his patrol cap, which was Ranger rolled, a manner of shaping a cap that was distinctly Ranger. "Put your gear down over there, Ranger," he said, pointing to a spot in the corner of the tent. "Get your tennis shoes on, stud." He was direct and to the point, leaving no question as to who was in charge. Stud was short for student, a term RIs commonly used when referring to Ranger students. RIs are the keepers of the tab and guides to a stud until he graduates, quits, or is removed from the course. Once a Ranger student begins the course, there are several ways out. He can receive a lack of motivation, LOM, which is essentially quitting. He could get dropped for a safety violation or get injured, medical drop, which was extremely common. Finally, he could become an academic drop for failing to pass patrols or for having a combination of patrol failures, low peer evaluations, and negative spot reports. The preferred option, the one we all sought, was to graduate and earn the tab. However, the ratio says it all. There are four ways to depart the course tabless and one way to earn it. Less than 50% of those who start the course finish, and of that 50%, most Rangers will recycle or repeat at least one phase of training. Only a handful of very fortunate and certainly competent Ranger students make it straight through the 68-day course unscathed. It was no secret that there's a lot of luck involved in earning the Ranger tab. On average, a typical day lasts 20-plus hours with 2.5 to 3 hours of sleep. Each student gets one meal per day on most days. Sleep and food deprivation significantly increase the likelihood of injury, particularly when one considers the risk associated with what a Ranger must do to get through the course. don't get hurt. That's the key. Each student is also allowed a maximum of 24 hours of sick call for the entire course, and it's cumulative. If a ranger has to go to the hospital or winds up with walking pneumonia, he'll easily exceed 24 hours and become either a medical drop or a medical recycle. In other words, as a reward for getting injured, a ranger either gets to start over or goes home. Don't get hurt, indeed. I sat down on my duffel bag and pulled my boots off. After lacing up my tennis shoes, the sergeant pointed to a group of students. "Go wait over there, Ranger." The quietness surprised me. I expected screaming, cussing, and ranting. I expected to see students doing push-ups or laying on their backs with their feet held 6 inches off the ground all over the place, but it was eerily quiet. The calm before the storm, I presumed. I saw another RI walk to the in-processing tent. He conversed with the RI that had received us, then took a piece of paper from him, and then headed our way. "You Rangers come with me," he said in a stern but professional tone. He also wore a black sweatshirt with a Ranger tab across the chest and a white name tag just above it. Students wore sterile battle dress uniforms, BDUs, which meant the only patches on our uniforms were our name and U.S. Army. No rank, no badges, no unit insignia. Regardless of rank, we were all equal in Ranger school, peers. Normally, I wore medium regular size pants, which meant medium waist and regular inseam. But in Ranger school, I knew we would not blouse the pants over the top of our boots. The pant legs would remain untucked. My normal pant length would almost certainly have to be rolled up to keep from dragging on the ground. So I bought several pairs of medium short BDU trousers at the Army-Navy surplus store. The pants looked like high waters hanging just above my ankles, but I never had to worry about them coming unrolled and dragging in the dirt. We followed the RI down the road to a grassy area. He pointed at one of the Rangers and then a spot on the ground. "Ranger, go ahead and get down for push-ups. You other Rangers, do an about-face and do not look back." We were standing on a bank just above the ditch that paralleled the road. "We're going to do the physical fitness test right here," I thought to myself. The ground wasn't even flat. We would essentially be doing push-ups with our feet elevated. That would put more weight on our arms, making the push-ups a lot more difficult. The physical fitness test to get into Ranger school was infamous. All a candidate had to do was 49 push-ups in 2 minutes, 59 sit-ups in 2 minutes, 6 perfect pull-ups, and run 2 miles in 16 minutes. The key to passing this test was not just doing 100 repetitions, which I could do on a standard Army physical fitness test. It was to do 49 very slow and deliberate, perfectly executed push-ups. If we went fast, we might do 100, yet only receive credit for 55. Or worse yet, we might even fail. Ranger lore had it that once the class was filled in terms of a predetermined number, everyone else would fail the physical fitness test no matter how good their push-ups and sit-ups were. That's why I had reported at 0500. We were told to report between 0500 and 0700. I wanted to be one of the first in line for the physical fitness test, just in case the rumors were true. Another twist was that the RI would not count repetitions out loud. He would simply say, "Begin." When he was satisfied that a Ranger had done 49 good enough repetitions, he would merely tell the Ranger to get up. This was both frustrating and stressful. It's impossible to adjust if you don't know how you're doing. I was fourth in the line of 6. "Begin, Ranger," I heard the RI tell the first Ranger student, who then began doing push-ups while the rest of us stood with our backs turned. The only thing I could hear was the sound of the Ranger's chest slightly touching the ground as he pumped out push-ups. Then I saw movement in front of me. Ever so slowly, a Ranger student 2 in front of me began to turn his head around in an attempt to take a peek at the Ranger doing push-ups. "Don't be stupid," I thought to myself. "Just do what he said." I suppose he assumed that the RI was totally focused on the student doing push-ups. He could not have been more wrong. "You! You looking back. Come here, Ranger, the RI said. The Ranger doing push-ups stopped and went to his knees as the RI turned his attention to the student ahead of me. Quickly, the Ranger stepped out of line and turned to face the RI. What's your name, Ranger? The Ranger gave his name. Johnson, Sergeant. Stanley Johnson. The RI made a note on the clipboard. I told you not to look back, Ranger. You can't follow instructions. You'll get somebody hurt. You're a safety violation. Now go retrieve your bags. And just like that, he was thrown out of Ranger school. The Ranger stared at the ground as he slowly walked back to the tent where we had grounded our equipment. His Ranger school experience had lasted less than an hour. He had not even broken a sweat. All the hard work he had done to get there, undone now by a simple movement of the neck. The inability to follow instructions. As we would come to see, there was very little margin for error at Ranger School, and quick missteps had instant and often serious consequences. The RI then returned his attention to the Ranger that was waiting on his hands and knees. Okay, let's continue, he said, and the Ranger student started push-ups over. Friends had advised me to be the gray guy. Don't stand in front, but don't stand in the back. Stand in the middle. Don't be first and don't be last. Be in the front one-third. Try to not be seen. It all made perfect sense to me. When it was my turn, I got down on my hands and knees. The dew on the grass was cold and wet. The RI announced, "Ready?" And I assumed the push-up position. Begin. And very deliberately, I began pushing. I counted 64 push-ups in my head before the RI told me to get up. Sit-ups went smoothly as well. The RI then took us out to a road where about 50 students were stretching their legs and jogging circles in the road to loosen up. By that time, it was getting light outside. A vast blanket of heavy white fog hung in the air, suffocating what little sound was produced. The stark contrast to my expectations of screaming and yelling made the situation more unnerving. I supposed it was intentional. All right, Rangers, this is the 2-mile run. Just stay on the road until you see an RI. He'll be standing in the middle of the road. That's the 1-mile turnaround. Circle him and come back. With that, the RI simply yelled, "Go!" And we were off. I could run 2 miles in less than 10 minutes. But the sage counsel to not stand out persisted in my head, so I settled in at about 10th place and remained there for the entire 2 miles. For the next 12 minutes, all I heard were tennis shoes pounding pavement and heavy breathing. As we finished, an RI directed us to stand aside and get out of the way. When the allotted 16 minutes had expired, several RIs stepped into the road and directed those still finishing the run to go to the tent and secure your equipment. Ranger school was over for them. As soon as the last man crossed the finish line, we loaded onto buses that transported us to the Harmony Church swimming pool for the Combat Water Survival Test, CWST. The test was straightforward. There were no hidden agendas. Everyone knew the standard before they reported to Ranger school, and they were supposed to have been tested at their pre-Ranger course. We had to swim the length of the 15-meter pool, conduct the equipment don and ditch, and finally finish the 3-meter blindfold walk. Like the physical fitness test, the combat water survival test was a drop event, no retest. If a student failed, he went home. It never occurred to me that a student would show up to Ranger school knowing that they would be thrown into a swimming pool and not know how to swim. Not until I saw it, that is. As I waited in line, I saw a student hesitate. It was his turn to jump into the pool and swim the 15 meters. "Let's go, Ranger. Get your ass in the pool," an RI with a thick southern drawl said. He looked at the water and kind of danced in place. He stepped up to the edge, but then retreated a step. I could see the fear in his eyes. "What the fuck, Ranger? Can't you swim?" the RI asked. The Ranger student inched up to the edge once again, and the RI shoved him from behind. The student threw his weapon aside as he entered the pool and instantly began flailing in the water. He bobbed and thrashed, his fear-raged eyes as big as saucers. He absolutely had no idea how to swim, not the faintest. "You dumb ass fucker," the R.I. said as he watched in amusement. I wondered if they were going to let him drown. Eventually, an R.I. casually walked to a fence that surrounded the pool and retrieved a hook on a pole, but did not rush to rescue the frantic ranger student. Instead, he watched as the student fought to keep his mouth above the surface, desperate for air. Finally, the R.I. extended the hook to the ranger, who clung to it like glue until he could grasp the side of the pool. "Rangers," the R.I. shouted. "They any more you dumb sons of bitches that can't swim?" Silence. "Save us the trouble. If you can't swim, just say so now, because I might lose interest and let your dumb ass drown." There were a couple of others who jumped in, then immediately clung to the side of the pool. No amount of urging from the R.I.s could convince them to let go, so two R.I.s grasped them by their BDU blouses and snatched them out of the pool. They all went home, and we never saw them again. I swam the length of the pool using the side stroke. We swam with all of our equipment and our boots on, but there was no time requirement, so if a student knew how to swim, it was not overly taxing. I then jumped into the deep end with my load-carrying equipment, LCE, and a rubber M16 rifle, a training device that soldiers affectionately called a rubber ducky. The requirement was to jump into the pool and completely submerge, ditch all of your equipment without any portion of your body breaking the water's surface, then swim to the side of the pool. The final task was a bit trickier for me. For this task, candidates climbed to the top of the 3-meter board, 9 feet above the water's surface. We wore all of our equipment and carried the rubber ducky. The R.I. standing at the top placed a blindfold over our eyes. He centered us on the board and ordered us to walk off the board. Ideally, we would walk straight forward, 1 foot in front of the other, until we fell off the end of the board. It's a very uncomfortable feeling knowing the fall is coming, but not knowing when. When my turn came, I remember looking down and seeing the low board to my left. "Whatever you do, don't fall off this thing to the left or you'll break your neck on the low board," I thought to myself. I don't have good balance in the dark. Never have. Apparently, it's a gene that I inherited from my father. For as long as I could remember, he walked like a drunk man crossing an icy road in the dark. The idea is to walk off and enter the water feet first. And it was in my best interest to ensure that the rubber ducky was well out in front of me when I entered the water. Otherwise, it would snap back and hit me in the face. I'd already seen two students make that mistake. Our eyes were attending to them presently on the side of the pool as blood spurted profusely from their faces. Carefully, I began to walk forward. 6 steps and I should be to the end, I thought to myself. I wish I could just jump off the end of the board. Jumping from this height did not bother me. It was walking a straight line blindfolded that got me. 1, 2, 3, free falling. On the 4th step, my left foot landed on the side of the board and off I went, sideways. And of course, I'd fallen off the left side. By the grace of God, I missed landing on the low board and I had the wherewithal to thrust the rubber ducky out in front of me as I entered the water. While still under the water, I could hear the muffled sound of R.I.s screaming and talking to one another. I knew it was about me. I wished I could stay under forever. I did not want to surface. What were they going to do? Did I fail? "Ranger, get your ass back up here," the R.I. atop the diving board shouted when I finally surfaced. I hustled back to the top of the board. "I told you to walk off the board," he said. Then he hesitated. "Which technically you did, but walk off the end, dumbass." Once again, he blindfolded me, centered me on the board, and I began to walk. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, free falling. I missed the board again and entered the water face first. All I heard when I surfaced was the R.I. at the top. "Dumb fucking ranger," he said. But I had technically passed the test. It took hours to run the several hundred students through the combat water survival test. Once everyone had been tested, we loaded on buses and returned to Camp Rogers. But with each test, our numbers had continued to thin. When the bus stopped, the RI sitting at the front stood and faced the back of the bus. "When you exit this bus, I want you to form three lines, Rangers." He then stepped off the bus and we followed him. Up until that point, we had just been a horde of Ranger students, but I realized that the RIs were about to assign us to companies. There were three companies in Ranger school: Alpha, Bravo, and Charlie. Rumors, lore, and legends abound when it comes to Ranger school. Every Ranger had been told by his buddies who had already gone through which company was the easiest at Fort Benning. I had heard Easy Alpha, Beano Bravo, and Christmas Charlie. I decided to cast my lot with Alpha Company, so I made sure I was in the first line. There were six of us who had graduated the officer basic course at Fort Rucker together, so we knew one another. We had been training together for the past 2 months. Since we were all together, we had heard the same rumor about Alpha Company being the easiest. We all tried to get in the Alpha Company line, but the lines were uneven, so they made several Rangers switch to another line. Ultimately, three of us made it into Alpha Company. We'd soon find out that we had chosen poorly. One by one, we printed our name on the list that assigned us to our company. As we did so, we were given a roster number. We would be known by our numbers for the remainder of Ranger school. Not a name, a number. My roster number, 007. Great, I thought to myself. That should get some attention. James Bond. After receiving roster numbers, we were directed into a building with tables lining both sides of the room, front to back, wall to wall. I turned the corner to enter the room, and all I saw was a long line of bare asses as students bent over tables. It was the dreaded gamma globulin shot. Gamma globulin is administered to boost a student's immune system. Our bodies were about to be reduced to nothing, and the environment we would be operating in was going to be harsh. We needed all the help we could get to keep from getting sick. The shot is administered to the buttocks, and it feels like a baseball has been inserted into your butt. Needless to say, the soreness that follows is dreadful. We had not been placed in companies or issued equipment before the physical fitness and combat water survival test because of the attrition rate. We had already lost a lot of would-be Rangers. Ranger assessment phase had only become a part of Ranger school in the mid-1980s. The cadre recognized that Rangers were showing up unable to meet the standards, so it was formally incorporated into the course. The entire first week is designed to quickly get rid of those that did not have the mental or physical toughness to make it through. There's a large black and gold sign at Camp Rogers with a Ranger tab in the middle. The sign says, "Not for the weak or faint-hearted." The sign says it all. As harsh and egotistical as it may sound, not everyone has what it takes to become a Ranger. It requires a degree of suffering that the average person is not capable or willing to endure. For this reason, it's best to weed out those who cannot or will not make it as early as possible in the process. Now that the initial attrition wave was over, we were taken to the central issue facility to draw our equipment. This took us well into the evening. Along the way, we were issued a meal ready to eat, MRE, portions of which we consumed on the move. Technically, we were only supposed to eat in the patrol base or when told to do so, but as hunger would increase, so would our tolerance for risk. We'd stuff crackers, dehydrated fruit, and the coveted Tootsie Roll into our pockets and take a bite when the RIs weren't looking. This would become our routine for the foreseeable future. Eat what you can, when you can, and do it while no one is looking. By the time we returned to the barracks, which was an open bay building with bunk beds from end to end, we were dog tired. It had been a very long and stressful day. At around 2200 hours, we were told to get some rack, Rangers. That was it. No one had really abused us at all. Everything that day had been conducted in a professional, business-like manner. Is this the way it's going to be, I wondered? As students began laying down, I noticed that some rangers stripped down to their skivvies.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.